Sure.
Like Harvey, right? The rabbit.
You know, this you know, like, I'll show up at a therapy appointment on Zoom, right? And this stupid bot shows up and I'm like, man, this is just not good, you know? Yeah, this is a recurring problem. Thanks for noticing.
Sorry about that.
It reminds me of that one thing that's on video these or on Zoom these days where the guy has his face is no longer his face, but a little kitten.
All right. Well,
but we could call it my guest and give me credit for bringing a guest.
There you go. Well, let's go ahead and get started. I've already hit record, so I'm going to ask that everyone please mute your phones. And as you have a part in today's meeting, I will ask you to unmute it. So welcome to the Rotary Club of Norfolk. We are first going to be led in song by Pam Tubbs. Pam?
Thank you, Jim Kitts. And you're going to let me share my screen?
You can fire away.
Okay. Can everybody see that? Let's see. Let me try again. Share screen. Here we go. There we go. Yay. All right. Let me put everybody up here, up where I can. Okay. So before we sing, there has to be a story. All right. And here we are. Just a few days after Valentine's Day, and I wanted to share with you that one of the founding fathers of the first Rotary Club in Chicago, Harry Ruggles, was a very moral man. He detested off-color language, malicious innuendo, and classless humor, and he argued in club meetings for clean language. I'm surprised that he had to argue for it, but that's beside the point. Little more than a year after Rotary had been formed, there was an evening meeting, this was in 1906, and the guest speaker began telling a story. And having heard it before, Harry Ruggles also knew that it had an off-color ending and felt it was inappropriate for the club. And he yelled, "Come on, boys, let's sing." And he jumped up in the chair in the middle of the joke, and he started leading the club and singing, "Let me call you sweetheart." Ah! Now, this was not only the first time that members had ever sung in Rotary, but apparently also the first time that a group of business people ever sang at a business meeting anywhere. And right then and there, it was decided that all subsequent Rotary meetings should be conducted so that any woman could attend without being embarrassed. Guests, that is, back then. And this has been an unwritten rule ever since, just as the tradition of singing has endured. So let's sing, shall we? Whoops. Let me call you sweetheart. I'm in love with you. We need a Rotary song, and I'm pleased to share with you that this will be a world premiere. I dug out this old song and wrote some new words to it. I hope you know the tune, and I hope you like the words. So here we go. Oh, course, we have to have a book slapper. Just a commercial announcement.
Pam, thank you very much. I am sure that there are thousands of Rotary meetings going on today throughout the world, and I bet not one of them has had a world premiere song sung at their meeting. So thank you very much. Absolutely appreciate it. It was great. It was great. And now, if you will all join me in the Pledge Allegiance, Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible with liberty and justice for all. And now, if you all join me in the four-way test of the things we think, say, or do, is it the truth? Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? And Bob Healy?
Will it be fun?
Thank you, Bob. I appreciate that. And now our invocation will come to us from Jim Sell.
Thank you. After all the hard times we've been through this year, the confluence of hope, love, and healing falls upon us today. We are bound together amid Valentine's Day, the aforementioned, the Lunar New Year, this is the year of the ox, President's Day, which is more than a good time to buy a mattress, as well as Mardi Gras, or Fat Tuesday, or in my tradition, it's called Shrove Tuesday. Bringing them all together, I offer this invocation. O God, who provides us with abundance and the bounty of life, inspire our celebrations of renewal and hope. Bless us as we raise our hearts in thanksgiving. Enliven this meeting of Rotary with wisdom, grace, and renewal. And through these sacred days, help us to go closer to you, to one another, and to the preciousness of our lives. Again, from my tradition, we utter one word on this day that will not be spoken again for 40 more days. What is it, Seeger? Hallelujah. Hallelujah is not said anymore after today. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you very much, Jim. Joe Massey, do we have a visitation report?
We may. We had a last minute request to add a member of the Suffolk Club. Jennifer Dilworth, do you have Miss Hopkins with you?
I am checking here now. I do not see her joining quite yet. Yeah, I don't see her on here quite yet. All right. I apologize for that.
If you do, let us know when you
sure,
do.
Sure, I will definitely do that. Thank you.
Uh-huh.
I do know that Jeff Wells has a guest. Jeff. Jeff?
I'm sorry. There you go. Brian Phelps.
How are you?
Hey, Brian.
Pleasure.
Brian hails from New York City and Maryland and working his way down the coast. He currently lives in Hampton, and he is a guest in my office today because he's also a fellow architect, and he's working on a few things. And I said, you need to know about Rotary, and you need to meet some really awesome people in this region now that you're coming down here.
Yeah, it's been quite interesting so far.
He especially liked the singing.
Well, again, just remember, you heard it here first, a world premiere from Pam.
You got it.
Yeah.
Thanks, Jim, let me add to the report that we need to open up the floor to anybody who may know of one of us being ill or sick.
The only one that I'm still aware of is, I'm sure Jason Drain is still on the mend from his knee surgery. Because that was just last week.
Right. Well, that's it.
Okay. Well, thanks, Joe. Appreciate it. We did our introduction of guests. Unless there's any other guests here that I might be missing, feel free to let us know. All right. Our school of the week is Poplar Hall Elementary School. Rotation scribe today is Dave Brandt. Dave, great to see you. Please, everyone, enunciate as much as you can, so Dave can get a good report. Lisa Barnes, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I missed the name of our guest. I'm already falling behind, I'm afraid.
Brian. What was Brian's last name?
It's Phelps, like the swimmer, Michael Phelps.
Is that Jeff Wells?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, good.
Yep.
Brian Phelps. Thank you.
All right. Thanks a lot. So Dave is our scribe, and now we'll move along to some fines and happy bucks. Who has some good news that they would like to share with the club? There's got to be
Bob Healy.
Bob Healy, go ahead.
Can I go? Okay. You may remember about a year ago, I announced and paid a fine when my son was promoted to captain in the Navy, like so many of our Rotarians. Well, a few months ago, he announced his retirement, and we were very pleased because he decided not to go back to sea for another 10, 11 years chasing a star. So as you Navy officers know, you still have to stay in rank for about 3 years before you can retire as a captain. So he found out yesterday, he's at the Pentagon right now, but he's going to San Diego to be the commanding officer of the naval base at San Diego. And I asked him, what about Norfolk? He said, that wasn't available.
Well, come on. It's hard to turn down San Diego.
I know. He's actually very happy. So, and then 3 years out there, he can retire.
Awesome. That's great news. That is great news.
I'll send you a check.
Okay. Thank you. Mike. Michael Desplaines.
So not happy bucks, but an announcement. If everyone could pass out or pass around the Norfolk Rotary Charities grant application, our club is giving out $50,000 in small grants. The application is very easy. It's a Word doc. They fill it out and email it to me. It's due by the end of the month. So please get it out to any 501c3 nonprofit in the area doing good work. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. Anyone else have some happy news they'd like to share?
My son, Lucas, I've been to a meeting a while, so this is a little old, I guess, but my son, Lucas, finished up his business degree at the University of Mary Washington. He was able to do it remotely, which was good since he only had two classes to finish. I didn't have to pay the whole semester worth of tuition to finish him up. But he finished up his business degree at the University of Mary Washington and has taken a job with ADP in Norfolk.
Awesome. That's great news. Thanks, Dave. Anyone else? Anyone else? I know one thing I just wanted to bring to your attention. Our club bookkeeper, Ann Morgan, is not feeling well. So just please keep her in your thoughts. I don't think it's anything overly serious, but I know that she's been a little bit under the weather for the last week or so. I have some happy bucks. Two things. One, got to spend some time this weekend down in Charleston, South Carolina with my son and his fiance. Wanted to have some happy bucks. Both of my parents and my wife's mother got their first COVID shot up in New York. So we're grateful for that. Anyone else have anything they'd like to add? I'm just looking quickly through the gallery. All right. Okay, thank you very much. Appreciate that. Our vice president in charge of programs is Lori Harrison. And Lori, without further ado, I'll turn the floor over to you.
Thank you. Our Rotarian of the day is Carlisle Roten. He has been a Rotarian for more than 28 years. And his favorite part of Rotary is that he enjoys seeing the smiles on the people that we help, especially the children. Some of his favorite projects have been Paint Your Heart Out, our literacy project, and of course our project with the Hunt and Why. And his fun fact, I think is pretty cool. He actually sang on stage with the Doobie Brothers. So I feel like we should get some mileage out of that one. But anyways, pretty cool. Anyway, so Carlisle, if you introduce our speaker, please.
Can he do it while singing?
Yeah, perfect. I think we should. I think he should.
The Doobies didn't invite me back. If that's any comment on my singing. Thank you. Our speaker today is Gary Ryan. She is the director and CEO of Virginia Museum of Contemporary Art. She's born and raised in Norfolk. She returned home in 2019 to become the executive director of the Virginia Museum of Contemporary Art and brought with her more than 20 years of leadership experience in both for the for-profit and not-for-profit sectors. Gary came to Virginia MoCo from the Katona Museum of Art in Katona, New York, where she was interim executive director as well as director of development. Prior arts experience includes leading business development at the Brooklyn Academy of Music and strategic initiatives at the Metropolitan Opera in New York City. She came to the arts after many years at Time Inc., where she led business development for People and Real Simple in print, online, and via licensing. She began her post-MBA career in brand management at Unilever. Ms. Ryan holds an MBA from the J.L. Kellogg School of Business at Northwestern, a BA from Dartmouth College, and graduated from Norfolk Academy. She has traveled extensively in South America, including Antarctica, is an avid swimmer, and the proud mother of Isabel Laterzo, a PhD candidate at UNC. Gary?
Hi, everyone. How are you doing? I'm glad the sun came out a bit. Let me share our screen. And I want to say thank you to you all for inviting me to share a little bit about Virginia MoCo with you this afternoon. And so I just need to make sure I have got it. There we go. Okay, go away. There we go. All right. So I'm going to give you a little bit of background on the Virginia Museum of Contemporary Art. And what I first want to say is thank you. We were the proud recipient of a grant last year from the Rotary Club. We received $500 from you and we applied it to this funny looking object in the left side. It's our art cart. which allows us to broadcast live from the galleries into classrooms throughout the Hampton Roads, elementary, middle, high school, and college students, as well as the U.S. Navy. So thank you so much. I just wanted to refresh your memory on kind of how MOCA started. It started in 1952, we're almost 70 years old. And it started really as a loose association of community members who decided to put on an art show to raise money to help defray some medical bills of a neighbor. Since then, we've gone through several iterations, and about 10 years ago, we became a nationally accredited and recognized museum. We are contemporary and non-collecting, so that's one of the ways in which we differ from, say, the Chrysler Museum, because we really are what we curate, and we adapt and reinvent our space with every exhibition. In terms of our mission, we've been working on the past year, despite COVID, more 18 months, we've been really been working on a new strategic plan. And our mission is that we're an ever-changing museum where neighbors, strangers, students, families, communities, and cultures are invited to explore our shared humanity through the contemporary art that is exceptional in all of its timeliness, restlessness, and beauty. And really the strategic pillars that are underlying everything that we do are four. And the first one is that we're about art first. The second is I'm happy to announce that we've been working on our positioning and our brand identity, and we'll be relaunching them both in the summer. We really care about our experience being inclusive and also remarkable, and that we're dedicated to operationally having flawless execution. So that's all well and good, but then COVID hit. So let me just tell you what we've been doing since last March when everything shut down. I just presented to the Virginia Arts Caucus earlier this morning. And one of the things I opened up with was the fact that on March 20th, I sent an email to the staff saying, there's a chance we're going to shut down because we don't have an endowment. We don't have a building that we can get a loan against. We have limited reserves. The city wasn't ready to step up in terms of money, donating emergency funds. Major donors were still just trying to figure out which end was up and how the stock market was doing and how their lives were being affected. But despite that, and despite being closed from March 15th until July 11th, when we actually opened up again to the public, our motto was the building is closed, but the museum is open. So we did that by launching a second web presence called virtualvirginiamoca.org that really gave a lot of insight into what was in the galleries. We had interviews with with artists, hands-on making projects for families. We also were partnered with WHRO, who were charged with actually delivering educational content into homes via the television. So we were a partner in supplying art curriculum there. We also really leveraged social media and had Instagram live studio visits and chats with artists. And we also live streamed a number of things on Facebook. And we were lucky enough to be able to get the exhibition installed before July 11th, more like the middle of June. And we gave a number of private exhibition tours. And the exhibition suite that was on and just closed really focused on, it was three exhibitions. One was called Shifting Gaze, Reconstructing the Black and Hispanic Body in Contemporary Art. New Waves 2020, which is a juried show of Virginia artists. And it was juried by an assistant curator from the Guggenheim this year in its 26th year. And also the first museum show in our community gallery of local artist Hampton Boyer, and this is actually a piece of his work. It happened to be fortuitously timed relative to what was going on in the world in terms of the death of George Floyd, and really was, it was really a poignant set of exhibitions that were up. And during, from July 11th and ongoing, the building is open, safe, and accessible. We were lucky enough with, we were fortunate enough that Sentara underwrote free admission for the first time with the Shifting Gaze exhibitions, and we've been able to secure additional free admission underwriting for this year and next. We also had safety protocols and timed entry. We launched for the very first time bilingual audio tours. So we had audio tours in both English and Spanish. We really worked on making sure that the labels had a lot of information in them and really were instructive and thorough. We did a lot of virtual programming. Like I mentioned, the virtual art cart involved students. And we also reached out to our partners in the community and offered our space to them at no charge. So Symphonicity came in and they were unable to perform at the Sandler Center. So they performed on our campus in a creative way. The Virginia Opera came and sang on our stage out front. And we were working with the Virginia Beach Little Theater, but because of some changes in the way the governor was allowing us to occupancy changes, that ended up not going forward. But we've also hosted a number of blood drives as well as a way to participate and support our community. So in terms of attendance for that last suite of exhibitions, Shifting Gaze, which just closed in the beginning of January, we had record attendance. Despite the fact that we had truncated hours, we were only open on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We still met the same exhibition attendance levels that we did with the exhibition prior to that, which was a solo show of the work of Virginia Beach born and raised Michael Kagan, who now lives and works in Brooklyn. And what we see on the attendance, see that chart of that map over there, is that we pull from all over. Only 30% of the guests that came were from Virginia Beach, and 70% were outside of Virginia Beach. About two-thirds of our guests were from the state of Virginia, and a third were from outside of the state. In terms of the community partners who we worked with to bring that forward, the list is long and includes the likes of Eastern Virginia Medical School, Norfolk State University, Teens with a Purpose, and so on. So if you think about where we are right now, what we strive to present in our galleries are exhibitions with local relevance and national resonance. Last week, we opened the exhibition on the left, which a suite of exhibitions on the which is on the left, which all have food as a theme. And this was actually an exhibition that wasn't planned for a couple of years. And given what we had to do to get through the tough part of COVID and really cut our budgets and look at what we were doing, we decided to bring that forward in time. And instead of using the money that we would use to pay to ship and pack all artwork, which is incredibly expensive and often equates to someone's salary, we decided to take, because we couldn't spend that level of money, we decided to take the money and give it to local artists and commission them to create work that was related to issues that our community was facing relative to food. And that was the exhibition in Nourish. We also partnered with the Chrysler Museum of Art, and we have a selection of their works on display that really reveal that food has been a theme in American art for a very long time. The next exhibition that's coming up after Nourish, I'll spend a little bit more time on Nourish in just a minute, is a series of exhibitions that we're titling kind of the suite of exhibitions. It's called The Summer of Women, which we also think is gonna be a really timely set of exhibitions, given the fact that and all the press that has been coming out recently, women are struggling in the midst of COVID, particularly mothers in particular, and that it's an interesting time to talk about, present and support women from an artistic point of view, but also from a broader cultural point of view. So going back to Nourish, I just wanted to show you who all the artists were that we paired. On the left, you'll see, you may know the name of Betsy DiGiulio. She's a new art professor at Norfolk Academy. Nikki Leone is based in Virginia Beach, but works all over the state. Clayton Singleton was on the cover of Distinction magazine this Sunday. And we paired them all with each with an expert. And we asked that artists were inspired by these food expert partners, and then kind of created work based on that relationship. CHKD was one of our partners, and we paired Ying Feng Chen, who is an artist based in Richmond, with CHKD, and specifically something called the Milk Bank, to really focus on pediatric nutrition. And then on the other end of the spectrum, we had Andy Harris, who is a teacher at Old Donation School and has a solo exhibition up right now at Old Dominion. We paired him with the Chesapeake Bay Foundation to talk about really oystering and the regeneration of oysters in this area. So I'm gonna just show you a clip that was on Wavy last week that gives you really a good sense of kind of what the exhibition also included.
It's often said art is a miracle neighborhood. It's often said art is a reflection on life. Over the weekend, the Virginia Museum of Contemporary Art opened a new exhibit, Nourish, exploring different aspects of how we see food. I was given the opportunity to shadow one of the artists involved and learn why this project for him is so deep. Globs of white, blue, and green paint, smoothed out as the brush meets the canvas. A masterpiece in the making by award-winning artist Clayton Singleton.
This piece is called Far From Manna.
In the painting, the passengers on the bus are on their way to a place inaccessible to them in their own neighborhood, a grocery store.
It's my interpretation of communicating some aspects about food desert.
The painting is a part of the Virginia Museum of Contemporary Art's latest exhibit, Nourish.
We commissioned 12 area artists to partner with the local food experts. Some paint, some sculpt. The nice thing is it seems like across the board, the artists have all really pushed themselves and really kind of gone further in their artistic practice.
Singleton's inspiration, his sister's neighborhood, a food desert.
I didn't want to read about what was going on. I wanted to hear about what was going on, and I wanted to talk to people who experienced this thing.
And that he did by taking a bus ride to the grocery store, even hosting a roundtable discussion with his sister and her neighbors in the St. Paul neighborhood in Norfolk. They've had a difficult time since the closing of the Save-A-Lot grocery store off of Church Street back in June of 2020.
Being that we don't have the store in our area, most of the people out here in the community are traveling from cabs, buses. They asking folks to carry them to the store. So it's a big inconvenience, not only the store, it's about getting there.
Singleton also reached out to St. Paul Community Development Corporation, a nonprofit whose goal is to improve the quality of life for families and individuals through stability and education. Over the summer, they stepped in to provide aid to residents after the Save-A-Lot closing.
The CDC worked with other organizations and with residents to do a food distribution over 2 weekends that distributed about 25,000 pounds of food.
Leah Marie adds, a food drive is just a temporary fix. The only way to solve an issue is to get to the root of it.
The pandemic of racism, pandemic of lack of food access.
those pandemics have been going on for many, many, many years.
Which is what Singleton hopes to shed light on through his painting, one brushstroke at a time.
You see the people on the bus who like live in an area that doesn't have food near them. That's what you see, but you don't see the history of why they're even there. They look like these pretty lavender lines, but you really don't know that under that is the map of the transatlantic slave trade. You can't see the redlining that was done here in the city of Norfolk that contained Black people.
Singleton believes those lines have evolved into walls that leaders in the community are refusing to climb over.
I don't know that we truly put ourselves in the place of other people. And I believe if we did that enough, parts of how we feel about people would start to change.
Because for Singleton, a change of heart will translate into a change in appetite and create a hunger for change within the leaders of our community and push them to provide a more sustainable way to nourish all. Nourish is now on display at the Virginia MoCA from now through June 6th.
All right, so that was a little bit longer than I remember it being, but thank you so much for hanging in there with me. So that was a big piece that was on Wavy TV 10, I think last week or the week before.
It's off.
Oops. So, and I'm just gonna, this is much shorter, but I just wanted to give you a little, an idea of another partnership. This is a little film on Andy Harris. One of the things we've done is we've commissioned a documentary about this whole process, and it's gonna be aired on WHRO. And this is just a teeny little clip. I know that you you guys are interested in the Chesapeake Bay, and I wanted to show you what Andy was up to.
Really. Being a part of a project like Nourish, it's pushed me out of my comfort zone again. It's making me grow. I mean, if you look at my art and my art is the same as last year, I'm doing something wrong. I want it to constantly be evolving. I think when people walk through the gallery and they see my work, what I really want them to connect with is how much emotion and thinking that I put into each little cut and each brushstroke. I was partnered with the Chesapeake Bay Foundation. Like more particularly, I went and observed their oyster harvesting events. Chris Moore, who is like an ecological scientist, complete expert, knows everything about it. I mean, he just blew me away with the amount of information he knew. He invited me to their oyster barges. We walked out this pathway, got on these boats that had these huge blue tubs. And in the tubs are tons of, they look, at first they seem like they're just half of an oyster shell. But if you look closely, they have little baby oysters growing on them. And what they do is they collect those oysters, put them in those bins, and they, over time, will grow new oysters that they can redistribute. And the impact they're having is incredible. I mean, as an artist, coming into that situation, seeing all this volunteer work and seeing the impact they're having, it was incredible. I wanted to make sure that whatever I made kind of gave a nod to that, kind of honored that. And so in my own personal work, I typically do objects or abstract pieces or landscapes and things like that. But I decided to jump into a section that I've just never really explored before, which is the human figure. This was perfect because I'm standing there at this event out in the rain, and I see all these people working in the rain. They don't care that it's raining. They're getting dirty. And I was just like, man, there's something here. And I used to spend so much time on the water. I used to spend so much time walking around those oysters. I've kind of drifted away as in my older age. I fish a little bit, but you know, I've drifted from that. So this project was really nice because it kind of brought me back into the smells, the feels, and the textures of the sea life, and the shoreline, and everything that's around us in this area. Being a part.
And then the one thing I want to do is I want to give you a little preview of what we've been working on that's going to be opening up in 2022. So we've been in conversation with the artist Maya Lin. You may know her as the student, the Yale architecture student who won the competition, design competition for the Vietnam War Memorial. She designed the Vietnam War Memorial in Washington. And since then, she's gone on to do a number of things. She's involved in redesigning the library at Smith College. She has had huge earthworks in a variety of places. She's had, this is actually a picture, I believe, from the Renwick Gallery in Washington, D.C., which is across from the Capitol. One of her pet loves is the Chesapeake Bay. And we thought, you know, given the fact that climate change is, you know, we're basically at, if you think about our area, we're almost at climate ground zero, being at the mouth of the Chesapeake Bay and the edge of the Atlantic Ocean. And so she's gonna come in and take over the entire museum and campus. We're getting works from her private collection, from her gallery, from private collectors. And she's also gonna be making work, bespoke work that speaks to an environmental issue that she cares about in this area. And we think it might be related to oysters. That's what she seems to be interested in right now. So we're super excited about that. That is, I believe, all I have to share with you right now, and I'd love to take questions.
Okay, do we have some questions for Gary?
We'll have to take in.
Yeah, Gary, I have one. You mentioned you're a non-collecting gallery.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little bit more about what that means? Why that's, what are the advantages and disadvantages of that?
So we don't have a collection. Our entire expense base is used towards putting up the exhibitions that you see. We don't have to conserve or collect or purchase work that we hold. What it allows us to do is to be super flexible and nimble and kind of be able to rearrange the pieces on the chessboard, like pulling the Nourish program forward. So we're relatively unique. There are only about 15 accredited non-collecting museums in the country. And the one in Katona was a non-collecting contemporary art museum. So that is a big difference. So we really are defined by the exhibitions that we put on every few months. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, yes, certainly does. Certainly does.
Good question. What about the Boardwalk Art Show? Is that happening or not happening?
So the Boardwalk Art Show is happening, we think. It got canceled last year. You know, it's historically been held in June, and June wasn't going to happen. So we made the move to shift it to October. And we were working very closely with the Atlantic Avenue Association and the Vibe to really make it a celebration of the area. But unfortunately, October this year wouldn't work. So it is on the books again. It's going to be moving to October for good, for a number of reasons. Having it the second weekend of June, 2 weeks before the end of our fiscal year, was really challenging from a budget and operational standpoint. So we think having it in the fall, far enough away from Neptune that we don't compete, and that's the plan, is that we're going to have it the third week of October. On the boardwalk, and again, with a lot of activity throughout the immediate resort area. Thanks for that question, Laurie.
Chris Bug.
Hey, Gary. How do y'all select exhibitions? I mean, is it competitive for the artists? Is it competitive from the gallery standpoint to try to get the artist or group of artists to come to our gallery? I mean, tell us a little bit about that.
So we have an exhibitions committee that meets, it's actually meeting tomorrow, it meets once a quarter. We plan our exhibitions 2 to 3 years in advance, which is like typical. Sometimes I think the Chrysler probably has a 3 to 5 year horizon, because you need time to fundraise and to assemble the works of art that you're going to be bringing into the museum. And there are 100 different ways to get them in. So with Maya Lin, we happened to know someone who knew someone who could deliver a letter that we wrote about why we thought her coming to this area would be compelling. And she said, yes. I mean, she could have said no. it's our job and our curatorial staff job to have those relationships across the country with other museums and with gallerists and with artists. So it's just, it's part of the job is to make those relationships happen. And then to have a program that artists want to be part of. I'm excited that Maya Lin.
Is it a mix of kind of one-off exhibitions where like the Maya Lin thing doesn't sound like she's doing a tour and stopping in Virginia Beach. It sounds like a one-off event. Is it sometimes like a tour that stopped an exhibition that's going through the country and stops here?
So Shifting Gaze was actually an exhibition that was curated by a museum in Orlando, the Mainello Museum. And we were the first stop after it originated at the Mainello, and then it's going on and going to other places. But Nourish, everything that's up right now is up and it's gonna be here and then it's gone. And Maya Lin, same thing. But we do look at traveling exhibitions. But what's so important is, again, kind of that local relevance, like making sure that there's some kind of connection to what our community is experiencing. So that's how it goes, Chris. Great question.
Michael, you had a question.
Hey, Gary. I just wanted to get a sense from you, how has the pandemic impacted you financially? What would you say, bottom line? You know, I think it's important for us as funders, you know, to hear how badly the arts section is hurting right now.
So on March 20th, I sent an email saying, I have no idea how long we're gonna be in business because our cash reserves at our current run rate gave us 3 months, right? And so despite that, we sharpened the pencil and we looked at our expense base, and unfortunately our biggest expense is salary.
Always is.
So we had to look really closely and we cut our staff to 40% of our pre-COVID levels.
Wow.
Which bought us another 3 months, so extended us. So we were in the process of just buying time. We then found out in early April that we were getting our first PPP loan, and we couldn't be, we were so happy to partner. Atlantic Union Bank was just an amazing partner who our former board chair is the regional lead. And we were first through, we were like testing the portal for them, which was awesome. So we applied and we found out on April 6th that we were going to get about $250,000. And the tricky thing was all of the FTE and the employment caveats, because there was no way we could keep part-time staff on. And I mean, we just couldn't survive given where we were. And that bought us that didn't buy us as much time as we thought it was, because by that time we figured out how many refunds we owed people from rentals and studio school and boardwalk. And then come the summer, one of the things we really did is we looked really closely at our business model and decided to only to fund the core business, which is museum operations. And then Boardwalk, Art Show, and Studio School, and all of the rentals, those were all like project budgets. We had to make sure that there was integrity in the core budget, which we did. And then in August, a lot of our outreach just started paying off. Like the board really stepped up. We had a couple of majors who hadn't been supporting us at certain levels step up when the Boardwalk Art Show was canceled. The city had given us incremental money in this budget and allowed us to use it for GOS, which was amazing, and marketing. And then we there was CARES Act money that came through the city of Virginia Beach that we applied for and received. And that helped defray some COVID expenses, but fortunately some of those COVID expenses could be staff salaries. And then we just applied for and received a second PPP loan in the beginning of February, and received notice that our PPP one was forgiven because that was not necessarily a grant. It could have been a low interest loan. And so right now we're in the process of putting pen to paper, looking at our next year's budget. But I feel bullish that we're going to be fine in the next year, but it's always touch and go. I'm not hiring a ton of people. We're really trying to use every dollar as wisely as possible.
Great. Thanks, Gary. Great job.
Thanks, Michael, for the question.
Any other questions for Gary? All right. Well, Gary, thank you very much for joining us. It was a wonderful presentation. Our club is very committed to childhood literacy. And so one of the things that we do to commemorate your visit with us today is we give a book to our school of the week. And this week, our school is Poplar Hall Elementary. So when schools are finally back in session on a regular basis and they'll allow you in, feel free to go in their library and you'll find a book engraved with your name commemorating your visit with us. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. That's wonderful.
Yeah. Couple more things. Jennifer, would you like to, I know your guest arrived during the meeting. Would you like to introduce your guest?
Sure. Hey, everyone. It's my pleasure and honor to be able to introduce Elizabeth Hopkins. She is the president-elect for the North Suffolk Rotary Club. And in addition to that, she does specialize in connecting you to the right professionals and resources for your legal issues with Legal Shield. So, Elizabeth, thank you for joining us. I do appreciate it.
Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you guys for having me. I was trying to get on and my PC decided to shut down. So, you know, but I'm here.
Okay. Well, welcome to the meeting. Welcome. And I wanted to just take a moment and give Bill Moore the floor just to talk to us a little bit about the Hunt and Why project. Bill.
Last week, Jim did a really great job telling you about a new project we've got there to create two Zoom conference rooms to assist in what they're doing with the kids there. While I was there working on setting that up, I learned of another issue that I'm trying to fundraise for. They have about 70 kids every day going to school at the Hunt and Y. They're out of 8 different schools, Zooming every day. Every kid has a different device, most of which provided by the local schools. On any given day, a number of them, like our guests, don't work for whatever reason. And what the Hunt and asked for, if we could do it, was to see if we can give them some backup. And they asked for 10 Surface Pros. And they cost on the low end about $250 a piece. I think I have money right now for 4. I would like to raise enough money to buy another 6, but I'll take whatever I can get and they will be better than they are right now. If you could make a contribution, mark it for the Hunting, and I will take care of it and it will be used well. And if anybody needs to call me or talk to me, just reach me through the website. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill. Well, thank you all for joining us. And thank you, Gary, for a wonderful presentation. Absolutely appreciate it. I do want to let everyone know that our next meeting will be March 2nd. And our speaker will be a former member of ours, Jose Hecking. I hope I'm saying his last name right. If you remember Jose, he was a officer in the Netherlands military who was stationed in Norfolk, and he's going to be speaking to us about his, I'm assuming it's the job he took after he had his posting in Norfolk, and it's going to be working in the Sinai peacekeeping operation. So we look forward to having him on March 2nd. Once again, this is one of the bright sides of having Zoom meetings is that we get to have people from all over the world. So I believe he'll be joining us from Europe. So thank you very much. I appreciate you all coming here. And thank you again, Gary. And we are adjourned, and we'll see everyone on March 2nd. Thank you.